Hey, Gary Hoover here. Today I want to talk a little bit about the financial services industry. I'm speaking in the next few weeks to a couple of different groups of bankers, larger banks and smaller banks, and I've spoken over the years to insurance companies and so on. And in my book I wrote 10 years ago, you can get the PDF online for $10, I call it The Art of Enterprise Now, but in that book I give all the things that I think make for great enterprises and what really separates the winners from the losers. And then I had chapters. I wrote too much to fit in the printed book, so they're only in the PDF version. They're also online. But what are the best and worst industries in America? Well, anyway, I said consumer banking is the worst industry in America. I said that 10 years ago, and I still believe it's true. It is overall so badly run and operating at such a lower level of competence than our overall business life. And I said that 10 years ago, and then the whole thing imploded the last few years, and like, oh, maybe it's worse than I thought, you know? Here's the thing. This is what to me is frustrating and yet huge opportunities for entrepreneurial thinkers. The thing about it, financial services is a wonderful field. It is only going to grow and grow and grow. It's going to grow. We got an aging baby boom in America, need help with their investments and how to manage their money and all sorts of things, how to plan for retirement, how to plan for trips, all sorts of things. We have young people, we have immigrants coming to this country that have no credit ratings. How do they get stuff? How do they move through the system? And then globally, you think, you know, most of those people in Africa, they ain't got checking accounts. And in 50 years, they're going to have checking accounts, and on and on. So it's a wonderful industry. It's part of the huge rise in services, right along with health services and education services, that the whole world is experiencing and will continue to experience for really hundreds of years as we rise in the whole services thing. So it's this great opportunity. And yet we look and we see the so-called leaders. I mean, there was a time when the Bank of America, run by a guy named Giannini, was innovative, was focused on doing cool new things for its customers that its competitors didn't do, that was obsessed with its customers and did amazing things and became, this Italian guy in the U.S. built the biggest bank in the world, you know? There was a time at which Merrill Lynch was a thing of beauty. It was the average investor's friend. It was Joe Blow on Main Street and Jane Blow, whatever, you know? And it was just a great outfit. And they used to give out this book, How to Buy Stocks. It was the most straight up, kind of like this guy Ramsey now, just straight up, or Clark Howard, you know, straight up advice about how to deal with your money. And in that case, they were focused on how to buy stocks. And it had been written or financed by the Merrill Lynch people. They were behind it. And they handed out brochures about how to read an annual report. They may still do some of that, but Merrill Lynch got into deep trouble. I guess nobody realized it. Even the guy running it says, well, I didn't know it either. Yeah, I don't know. And then they get bought by Bank of America, like, oh, we aren't doing enough. We already got 6 zillion branches, and we already got all these other things going on. Let's also buy one of the biggest stock brokerage firms in the world. And then, you know, the whole thing imploded. The Bank of America realized, oh, we shouldn't have bought Merrill Lynch. The Bank of America implodes the whole thing. Warren Buffett just helped bail them out. What a mess. What a disaster. I worked for two banks, my hometown bank when I was in like high school and stuff, and then I worked for Citibank in New York under a brilliant leader, a CEO named Walter Wriston, who really kind of conceptualized the giant global bank in a good way. And it just completely collapsed over the last 20 years. And it's come back, and it's looking better. It's so sad. And you know, even the great insurance companies, Prudential and Metropolitan, I guess they're still strong, but most of the energy seems to be at Geico and USAA and Liberty Mutual and Progressive and, you know, newcomers, innovators. And I just see, and it isn't that there aren't some great companies. Man, study Edward Jones, study Northwestern Mutual Life, study your local credit unions. But overall, the industry just has bad leadership. The people at the biggest companies, it's kind of the opposite of the soft drink business, man, you know? Study the people who run Coke and the people who run Pepsi. Oh, man, those are some good people. Study the people who run UPS and the people who run Federal Express and what they do and how they think. We need some of that over here. So what are some of the things that are going on and where are some of the opportunities? Because if you're an entrepreneur in this field, the opportunities are unbelievable, unbelievable. So one thing, differentiation, specialization. Most of the big banks say, I want to be a supermarket of financial services. I want to offer everything. I guess that's why Bank of America bought Merrill Lynch. and a whole bunch of other stuff. They buy Countrywide, I think, the mortgage guys, and also got them in trouble. The idea of being everything to everybody doesn't work very often, and it usually only works for one or two companies. You know, IBM had a good run being everything for everybody in computers for a long time, 20, 30 years. But finally, they started getting chipped away at, first by the mini computers with Digital Equipment and Data General and Hewlett-Packard, and then by the microcomputer. And although they played a role in the birth of the microcomputer, an important one, the PC as we know it, they ended up lost that battle and sold it off to, you know, the Chinese, to Lenovo, that operation. I went to New York City for the first time in the mid-60s, 64, 65, for the New York World's Fair. My parents took us there. And when you went, there were like 10 or 12 big department stores. There was Altman's, and there was Orbach's, and there was Macy's, and there was Gimbel's. And well, you go today, and almost all those guys are gone. Now, Macy's is still there. They were the biggest. So maybe if you're the biggest, you can make that strategy work. And maybe if you're the biggest bank, you can be all things to all people. But the history would indicate the money is in the niches. There's more money selling just car insurance or focusing like Geico does, you know, or USAA, focus on a customer base. Focusing on military people has been their great strength. Edward Jones, they don't want to be Goldman Sachs. Goldman Sachs is a great company. Edward Jones says, we don't need any skyscrapers. We don't need a big fancy Manhattan office. We just got little tiny offices all over America. And they're local people helping their friends in almost a franchise system. A wonderful company. So how do you find that niche? How do you find that opportunity? How do you specialize? I mean, like if you're in banking, consumer banking, loaning money to people and taking their deposits, man, in a city the size of Austin, you could run a bank just serving doctors. You could run a bank just serving lawyers. You could run a bank just serving women. You could run a bank just serving Latin customers, Hispanic people. And you could go deeper than that. You could make it more finely divided. Or certain types of markets. I'm on advisory board. A company does a lot of work with the Pentagon and the government. And they get these contracts and go, oh, we got, you know, X million dollars in hand. It's a done deal. Oh, yeah, but they're going to be 60 days late paying us or whatever. So they need financing for that. Well, if you had a bank or a lending organization that focused on how do you work with organizations that work with the federal government, you'd understand. You'd become an expert at that. You'd become good at that. You could blow away your competitors. That might be a national bank instead of a local one. There have been some innovative banks coming out of Silicon Valley trying to serve those young growth companies with venture capital backing. But overall, and I'm picking on the banks, but all these financial services. Find that niche. The money is in focus and specialization, and the people in that industry don't seem to totally understand that. Or look at Aflac, man. What an unusual outfit that is, huh? And a huge success. The bottom line on all this is, who is obsessed with their customers? Who is totally focused, totally engaged, who successfully puts themselves in the shoes of their customers? One of the banks I'm very familiar with, I'm a customer. Their drive-through thing is a disaster. I drive up, well, I deal with a couple of banks. I drove up to one the other day. I won't tell you their name this time. And I'm sitting there, and I drive into the drive-through window to make a payment, whatever. And I'm sitting there, and I realize, well, wait, I got in this line because there were three cars in the other line. And I look over and realize, well, the three cars in the other line, there's no people in any of those cars. Those are parked cars. And then I see a little taped-up sign on the drive-through window that says, this is not the drive-through anymore. We built new ones around behind. I shouldn't have discovered it then. Those people running that bank never go through the drive-through. Their checks are all in automatic deposit, or their assistant deposits their check, or what, you know, they don't know what it's like to be a customer. I often tell the story. I think I put it in my book. I was frustrated. ATMs weren't working at the Austin airport. I'd come back from a trip, hauling all my luggage around, full of books like always, and I try an ATM and it isn't working, no money. And I say, well, I'll go. There's another one down there. I can see the light on it. It looks like it's working. I went down there. It wasn't working either. I said, well, I've got to save other people from this agony, you know, just to be nice to other people. And I reached underneath and unplugged. You know, it's an unprotected plug there. Pretty weird. Unplugged that machine from the wall. The light went out. Nobody else is going to get misled like I was. You know, it's out of money, but let's unplug it. I'm traveling, like, I don't know, a week later, going out to the same airport, you know, Austin Airport. And I'm like, oh, my goodness, I unplugged that machine, didn't I? I better go check on that. And I go looking at it. It's still unplugged. There had to have been 15 vice presidents of that bank go through that airport in that week. Not one of them looked at that thing. Not one of them cared. If I had gone to the Taco Bell and reversed some of the letters on their sign or tweaked something, I got to assure you, they're like, oh my goodness, there's somebody screwing around with our image, with our wonderful Taco Bell, you know, self-esteem, you know. They're proud of what they do. They love what they do. Where is that in financial services? Where is that living like a customer, breathing like a customer, being in touch, continually talking to a customer? Study A.G. Laffley, the guy that took over Procter & Gamble in like year 2000, ran it for 10 years. Company had gone kind of sleepy, kind of flatlined a little bit. He doubled the sales and quadrupled the earnings. Read about how he did it. Talk to the people that work for him. Talk about how you go stay overnight with your customers. You get inside their heads and inside their lives, and you really care about them. We see so little of that. And when I see the banks complaining about the credit unions, well, they don't pay taxes, they have unfair advantages, get off of it. Go hang out. Go apply for a loan to a credit union. Go deal with them. See what the experience is like and how it's just a different trip from what's going on in most of our banks. So I guess the bottom line here is I'm excited like always. I'm excited about the opportunities here. And if just, man, for my sake, for America's customer sakes, if somebody would just see the light, or more people would see the light, the opportunities are enormous. And man, if the big guys keep going down the pikes they're going down, they are doomed. I know it'll take them forever to die, and maybe their commercial banking, because I'm really talking here about consumer banking, although I'm sure we could use more innovation on the commercial side too, but maybe that'll carry them. But you know, American and Delta thought they ruled the world, and they thought Southwest Airlines was a joke. GM and Ford ruled the world. They thought Toyota was a joke. Sears and Penny and Kmart ruled the world. They thought Walmart was a joke. IBM thought Dell was a joke. Over and over again, watch those guys, because the people that innovate, the up-and-coming companies that love their customers, they win, and they win every time. Well, that's enough for today. Hope you're doing all right, and I'll see you later. Gary Hoover from Austin, Texas. Adios.